السلام عليكم جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، الحمد لله الذي يجيبني حين أناديه ويستر علي كل عورة وأنا أعصيه، ويعظم النعمة علي فلا أجازيه. نحمده ونسبحه ونقدسه على آلائه ونعمائه، ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، إلها واحدا أحدا فردا صمدا قيوما، نؤمن له بالربوبية ونقر له بالعبودية. من يهدي الله فهو المهتدي، ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا. ونشهد أن سيدنا محمدا عبده ورسوله أرسله بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك وترحم على محمد وآل محمد كأفضل ما صليت وسلمت وباركت وترحمت وتحننت وسلمت على إبراهيم وآل إبراهيم في العالمين، إنك حميد مجيد. وصل اللهم وسلم على جميع الأنبياء والمرسلين، وعلى الأوصياء والأصفياء والصديقين والشهداء والصالحين، وعلى عترة نبيك الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين، والصفوة المنتجبة من أصحابه الميامين، ومن تبعهم بإحسان وإيمان إلى يوم الدين. عباد الله، أوصيكم وأوصي نفسي بتقوى الله ولزوم أمره. قال ربنا العزيز في كتابه الكريم، أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم: يا أيها الذين آمنوا لا تتخذوا بطانة من دونكم لا يألونكم خبالا ودوا ما عنتم قد بدت البغضاء من أفواههم وما تخفي صدورهم أكبر قد بينا لكم الآيات إن كنتم تعقلون. وما تخفي صدورهم أكبر قد بينا لكم الآيات إن كنتم تعقلون. صدق الله العلي العظيم. In the previous session we spoke about the importance of reason in Islam, and how reason and aql, the intellect, enjoys a paramount position in our faith, and that our faith goes hand in hand with reason. It is based on reason. One of the main sources of legislation and tashri' in Islam is aql, is reasoning. Al-aql al-alim وليس العقل الجاهل. You may come to me sometimes and say, Sayyid, my aql tells me wine is good for my health. So should I follow my aql? No. This is not the right aql. The aql which has faith. The faithful aql, not the faithless aql. There is a difference between them. We have two brains. One of them is a brain embedded in faith, and the other is a brain that is stripped from faith. So when we say aql always, the aql, we refer to the aql which is faithful. The aql that believes in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is the complete aql. Whenever the Quran says al-aqilun, it's a reference to this type. To the believers who have faith. Not people who have reason, but they don't have faith. Aql without faith is incomplete. Because the hadith says that through aql we discover God. The job of the aql, the first job, the first function of the aql, the first outcome of the aql is to recognize your Lord and your duty towards Him. This is the aql. Al-aql ma'ubida bihi al-Rahman waqtusiba bihi al-Jinan. If this aql, God is not worshipped by this aql, and Jannah is not obtained by this aql, this is not a aql. This is not a complete aql. And therefore, when we look at our Islamic heritage, When you go into a library and you start reading Islamic books and tafsir, interpretation of the Quran, and hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in Islamic history and other subjects, you would come across certain things that are superstitions and myths and fake stories and fake hadiths and fake interpretations in the Islamic heritage. We Muslims, we do not say everything which is found in any Islamic book is accurate and correct. This is not the case. This will happen one day when we go to paradise. Authors in paradise, when they write a book, then everything is going to be accurate. Only in paradise, but not on earth. Because in paradise, people, تَكْتَمِلُ عُقُولُهُمْ, they're going to be matured intellectually, emotionally, psychologically, they're going to be matured, then what they say, what they write is going to be accurate. But here we are still on earth. We are in Orange County. We are not in paradise yet. So you come across stories that does not make sense and it goes against aql and reason. And we discover this is not Islamic. These things have creeped in our heritage, Islamic heritage, by two groups. One, I mentioned them in the past for several weeks. A group of, to say the least about them, fabricators, who were professionals in fabricating and making up a hadith. This was their profession, this was their talent, their job, is to author a hadith and easily attribute this hadith either to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam or one of other messengers, or sometimes to one of our imams, the family of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is one group, fabricators, al-wadda'un. The legal term of it in the Islamic heritage is al-wad', fabrication. Al-wadda' is the fabricator. The other group, they were non-Muslims before, and they accepted Islam during the time of our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but their journey to Islam was still incomplete. So they brought with them what they learned in their own religions, Christianity and Judaism. And this type of hadith that they brought with them and these stories and superstitions were called Isra'iliyat. In the Islamic terminology, it's called the Isra'iliyat, the Israelites, meaning these traditions that which came from other religions, sometimes from Torah and Injil and other books. Other books too came into our religion through those, some of the converts. Most of those converts were Jews who accepted Islam, most of them. And they were monks and rabbis. They were in Arabia. You know, in Arabia was part of it was center of Judaism, Medina. The same city of Medina today, the capital of Islam, was the center of Judaism. There were tribes who lived there for many, many years. And in Yemen also, in Yemen there were some Jewish communities. Wahab ibn Munabbih is one of them. Abdullah ibn Salam is another figure. Many figures. I'm just mentioning a few names here. Ka'b al-Ahbar, another name, and we're going to give you a sample of what they brought into Islam from their own religions, which is sheer superstitions. It is baseless. It has no Islamic base, neither Christian or Jewish base. It was fabrications made in their own religions, attributed to their prophets, and then it was transferred and borrowed from their religions into Islam during the time of the Prophet and after the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And they found some naive people in the Muslim community, some naive people. And I will mention their names, inshallah, next week. And they took advantage of those naive people. They told them these stories, fabrications, and they took it from them, those naive people, and started spreading these stories as if they are authentic and genuine. قال رسول الله. It was very easy just to put this term in the beginning. قال رسول الله such and such and such and such. And people would believe in that. And who's that intelligent person who would sit there and cross-examine this hadith and compare it to the Quran or to other hadith and find out that this is not true? Where is this Muslim? Where is this intelligent person? So they started also to transfer these hadith to the next generations until today. Today you find some imams in many Islamic centers and mosques throughout the Muslim world. They stand on the podium, they narrate a hadith, and they attribute this hadith to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where the Prophet is the last one to know about this hadith. He's the last person to know that he said this hadith. Still, this tragedy exists. One of them, it made a huge scandal in Egypt 7 years ago, 5 years ago. Irda'u al-Kabir. How many of you Arabs here, you remember this story? Irda'u al-Kabir. The suckling of the man, not a baby. Breastfeeding. Breastfeeding of a man. Yes. So they said there was a question that how can a man sit in an office, in his office, with a person, a female, who's non-mahram to him? They sit behind the closed doors in an office. They work in an office. This is illegal to be a male and female non-mahram to each other, non-related to each other. They sit in one room behind the closed doors. So the genius, one of the genius sheikhs there in Egypt, he came up with this very, very easy solution, practical solution. He said, no problem. She would breastfeed him, this guy, who's 40, 50 years old, with a huge mustache, you know. And he becomes, you know, mahram to her. And when they told him, how do you say this? He said, listen, this is not me. Go and read our books, Sahih al-Bukhari, Sahih al-Muslim, Sunan al-Nisa'i, Tirmidhi, Ibn Majah, this and that. Go and see this. It's a hadith. It's a hadith. It's a truth. It's a hadith. But this hadith is fabricated hadith. It's not a genuine hadith. It's not a genuine hadith. So this is one example of the suffering that the Muslim ummah had and still have when you find such things, such stories, fabrications, lies being told and unfortunately attributed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. As-Sadiq al-Amin, the person who says nothing but wahi, but revelation, pure revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now the question is, and was in the past, can we quote, let's say, the Torah and the Injil and the non-Islamic books and sources of hadith and verses? Is it okay for the Muslims to do so? In the beginning of Islam, we come across certain verses in the Quran that allowed the Muslims, when they have a discussion with non-Muslims, with the people of book, with merely Jews and Christians, to quote their books. One of them, Surah Yunus, verse 94. فَإِن كُنْتَ فِي شَكٍ مِمَّا أَنزَلْنَا إِلَيْكَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is addressing the community through the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We know that in the Quran, many times when Allah speaks to the Prophet, He's using the Prophet as a means and vehicle to address us, the Muslim Ummah. So here, it is not the Prophet who has doubt about what Allah is saying. It's some of the people in the community, but He's addressing them through the Prophet. فَإِن كُنْتَ, if you have doubt, فِي شَكٍ مِمَّا أَنزَلْنَا إِلَيْكَ. You have doubt in what we have sent to you in our book in the Quran. فَاسْأَلِ الَّذِينَ يَقْرَؤُونَ الْكِتَابَ مِنْ قَبْلِكَ. Go and ask those, مِنْ قَبْلِكَ, those, the Jews and the Christians, the people of the book. Go and ask them, we said the same thing. The same thing we said to you is found in their books. Let them go and double check this in their books. The same reference, the same verse is in their own books. Another place, Surah Al-Isra, وَلَقَدْ آتَيْنَا مُوسَى تِسْعَ آيَاتٍ بَيِّنَاتٍ فَاسْأَلْ بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلِ إِذْ جَاءَهُمْ. Go and ask. Allah is saying to the Prophet during his time, go and ask the Jews, Bani Israel, the signs that we sent to them with Musa alayhi salam. So at that time, Allah would ask the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and some of the Muslims and the scholars to go back to the people of book and check what is being told in their books. Allah says the evidence is also found in their own books. But later on, the story changed. One, these fabrications started to surface and they started to spread them against Islam. Here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after that, forbid the Muslims from going to the books of non-Muslims, to the earlier books. In Surah Al-Imran, ayah 118, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. O the community of believers, لَا تَتَّخِذُوا بِطَانَةً مِن دُونِكُمْ. Do not seek intimate friendship. بِطَانَة is an intimate friendship with non-Muslims. مِن دُونِكُمْ, other than you. لَا تَتَّخِذُوا بِطَانَةً مِن دُونِكُمْ. What type of people that we have to avoid? All of them? No. Listen to the description. لا يألونكم خبالا. They do not, those who do not fall short of disturbing you, inflicting a loss upon you. Those who want to disturb your religion, disturb your aqidah, your faith, your belief. لا يألونكم خبالا. يعني لا يقصرون في إفساد عقولكم وذهنياتكم. They want to confuse you. They come to you trying to confuse you. Don't befriend them. Don't mingle with them. Don't associate with them. وَدُّوا مَا عَنِتُّمْ. They love to see you being confused and distressed and lost. وَدُّوا. They enjoy this. وَدُّوا مَا عَنِتُّمْ قَدْ بَدَتِ الْبَغْضَاءُ مِنْ أَفْوَاهِهِمْ. You can see when they speak, you can see the hatred comes out of their mouths. وَمَا تُخْفِي صُدُورُهُمْ أَكْبَرُ. The hatred that they conceal in their hearts, it's even much bigger. قَدْ بَيَّنَّا لَكُمُ الْآيَاتِ إِن كُنْتُمْ تَعْقِلُونَ. In this case, you should not go to them. Don't read their books. One day, Umar ibn al-Khattab, the second caliph, came with a book from the people of Kitab, Ahlul Kitab. He brought this book to the Prophet, showing this book to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. فغضب رسول الله. هذا أخرجه الإمام أحمد بن حنبل. This hadith is found in the book of Musnad Ahmad ibn Hanbal. He came, he brought a book, a Jewish book, showing this to the Prophet, and he enjoyed reading this book. So he wanted to convince the Prophet to read it, or you know, to get what is inside this book. فغضب النبي وأمره أن لا يسألهم بشيء. The Prophet said, don't go and get a book. You have the best book available, the Holy Quran. Why do you have to go to other books? And then the Prophet, this is what he said to him. وَالَّذِي نَفْسِي بِيَدِهِ لَوْ أَنَّ مُوسَى كَانَ حَيًّا الْيَوْمِ مَا وَسِعَهُ إِلَّا أَن يَتَّبِعَنِي. O Umar, do you know that if Musa alayhi salam is alive today, he will come and follow me. He would come and ask me. Not that we go and ask them. We have the Quran, and the Quran is the integration and the completion of all scriptures, all religions, all revelations. Why should we go and read other books? And in Sahih al-Bukhari, there is a whole chapter titled, La tas'alu ahl al-kitab an shay'. The Prophet asked his companions, never go to the people of Book and ask them about anything, because the answer is going to be confusion. They're going to confuse you. You are not going to get the right answer. Things have been politicized. They are not going to give you the correct answer anymore. So don't ask them what is inside their books, and do not depend on what is in their books. Sometimes we say in the Torah and the Injil, وَمُبَشِّرًا بِرَسُولٍ يَأْتِي مِنْ بَعْدِ اسْمُهُ أَحْمَدٍ. We say, see, in this book and that book, in this chapter and that chapter, the name of the Prophet came heralding the arrival of the Prophet. We might do this, but to depend on the facts found in their books, they call them facts, we don't call them facts. In their books, this is wrong. I know some of the Muslims are enchanted with the temples and the cathedrals and the churches and the sermons, and you know, we don't have what they have. Compare our masajid to their temples, no way you can compare. Our masajid are humble. People sit on the floor. We don't have dancing a group, this and that, we don't. I don't know how to do that, you know, unfortunately. We don't know how to entertain you. We give you only boring lectures. They have different musical groups and this and that. So they get enchanted and they go there and wow, look at what he's saying. Everything he's saying is there in your book. You don't have to worry. Read your book, read this book. If he's saying good, then also it is here. It's found in your Holy Quran. It's found in the tradition of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and our imams. It is found. But unfortunately, sometimes we don't read, sometimes we don't have access to it, sometimes we do not know how to transfer this to the populace. We don't know. We don't have these means. They have these means. They know their work very well. They are very professional. We are not professionals. We are not. Most of the Friday prayers, if you go and look at the people sitting in a Friday prayer, 99% of them are taking a nap, beautiful nap. Who pays attention to the imam? They don't pay attention. But their business is different in these temples and churches. So some people, naive people, they get enchanted by that. Islam says no. You have to listen to the truth. Listening to the truth is important. Bismillah. And we will continue on this subject, inshallah ta'ala. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Wal asri inna al-insana lafi khusrin. إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر وصلى الله وسلم على سيدنا محمد وأهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين نحمده ونسبحه ونقدسه على آلائه ونعمائه ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن سيدنا محمدا عبده ورسوله أرسله بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله اللهم صل وسلم وبارك وترحم على محمد وآل محمد كأفضل ما صليت وسلمت وباركت وترحمت على إبراهيم وآل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد وصل اللهم وسلم على خلفاء نبيك وأوصيائه وأهل بيته وأحبته علي أمير المؤمنين وقائد الغر المحجلين وعلى البضعة الطاهرة فاطمة الزهراء سيدة نساء العالمين وعلى سبطي نبي الرحمة وسيدي شباب أهل الجنة الحسن والحسين عليهما السلام وعلى علي بن الحسين ومحمد بن علي وجعفر بن محمد وموسى بن جعفر وعلي بن موسى ومحمد بن علي وعلي بن محمد والحسن بن علي والخلف الهادي المهدي عجل الله تعالى فرجه وسهل مخرجه وجعلنا من أنصاره وأعوانه عباد الله أوصيكم وأوصي نفسي بتقوى الله ولزوم أمره قال تعالى في كتابه الكريم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والذين يؤذون المؤمنين والمؤمنات بغير ما اكتسبوا فقد احتملوا بهتانا وإثما مبينا صدق الله العلي العظيم. One of the most important social aspects of Islam, of our religion, is the respect for others. Try not to hurt others. Try to curtail harming and hurting and inflicting damage on people around you. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "Al-Muslimu man salim al-Muslimuna min lisanihi wa yadihi." The perfect Muslim is the one that Muslims around him, his family, his neighbors, his community, his friends, his co-workers, around him, they feel at peace. They don't feel they are being intimidated or threatened or abused or insulted by him. Min lisanihi, from his tongue, because some of these tongues are sharper than a knife, unfortunately. Does more damage than a knife or a sword. من لسانه ويده ويده. Physical and verbal. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم says, خصلتان ليس فوقهما شيء من الشر. Two traits. Nothing above them in evil, in wickedness. One of them, the first, الشرك بالله, to disbelieve in your Lord, to reject your Lord. الشرك بالله والضر لعباد الله, and being harmful to the servants of Allah. Being harmful. Being a source of tension in your community, in your society. Source of tension. And then he says, on the other hand, وخصلتان ليس فوقهما شيء من البر. And two traits. Nothing is above them in a beauty, in kindness, in wholesomeness. The first, الإيمان بالله. The firm belief, the firm friendship with your Lord. والنفع لعباد الله. And being of benefit, of help to the servants of Allah. People who are around you, you help each and every person. I know some people in our community. If you count 500, 5,000 people around him, each and every person of them, old, young, male, female, believer, non-believer, Muslim, non-Muslim, they have received some good benefit from him or her. I know such people. They do nothing but good. They spread goodness and help and relief and peace and a smile on people who are around them. This is Islam. This is Islam, nothing else other than that. This is, if you put this book, this whole Quran in one sentence, it is to do good to others, not just to your neighbors, to others. Knowing them or you don't know them. From your village or from another planet, do good to them. Don't hurt them. من آذى مؤمنا فقد آذاني قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. He who hurts a believer, he's hurting me. وَمَنْ آذَانِي فَقَدْ آذَى اللَّهِ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى. And if you hurt me, the Prophet, you are hurting God. وَمَنْ آذَى اللَّهِ فَهُوَ مَلْعُونٌ فِي التَّوْرَاةِ وَالْإِنْجِيلِ وَالزَّبُورِ وَالْفُرْقَانِ. The one who hurts his Lord, he's being cursed. Cursed, he's away from God's mercy. Not only in the Quran, in the Old Testament, the New Testament, the Psalm, and the Quran, in all these books. لا يحل للمسلم عن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم. لا يحل للمسلم. It is not permitted for you as a believer. أن يشير إلى أخيه بنظرة تؤذيه. الله أكبر. Even to have a bad look, a glance, quick glance, quick look, a bad one to your brother in religion, to someone who's sitting next to you. Don't hurt him even with your looks, let alone your mouth, your speech, even your look. Don't give him the dirty look. لا يحل, it's not permitted. And on the other hand, see, when you honor others, what you receive. من أتى أخوه المؤمن, who comes to his brethren, and here أخ means brother or sister in faith, فأكرمه, he would honor him, respects him and honors him, فإنما أكرم الله عز وجل. My friends, how many of you have seen God? None of you. How many of you has touched God and shook hand with him and embraced him? Huh? Unless you ate something last night, huh? Don't tell me. None of us. How do we shake hand with him? How do we greet him? How do we embrace him? Don't we love him? By embracing each other's. The hadith says, on the day of judgment, a person stands before Allah. Allah says to him, I am upset with you. He says, why? I worshipped you, I loved you, I obeyed you. He said, yes, but remember, when I was sick, you did not visit me. The man says, you get sick? You don't get sick, you are perfect. He said, عندما مرض عبدي المؤمن فلم تزر. My servant, he was sick. You did not, you neglected him. You didn't even ask about him. He was in the hospital for 6 months, for 1 year. You went everywhere, you went shopping, you went traveling, but you didn't give 15 minutes to go and visit him. عبدي المؤمن, هلا زرت عبدي المؤمن فوجدتني عنده. Do you want to find me? Go and visit my servant who's a believer. You find me there. This is the beauty of Islam. Never ever hurt any person. Be very careful. It has dangerous consequences. من أهان لي وليا فقد بارزني بالمحارب. Allah says, الحديث القدسي, حديث القدسي narrated by him, by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you insult, if you degrade, disrespect, waliyan, one of the awliya, and who knows who's the wali? Wali does not have a specific shape or address. Any person could be wali. Only Allah knows about the hearts and the intentions. If you insult him, فَقَدْ بَارَزَنِي, you confronted me in war. You stood before God and you said, God, I want to fight against you. فَقَدْ بَارَزَنِي بِالْمُحَارَبَ. There is zero tolerance for this in Islam. Zero tolerance for disrespecting and insulting others. This is the beauty of our religion. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to enable us to be not only Muslims, but good Muslims. Role models for others, inshallah. اللهم اغفر للمؤمنين والمؤمنات والمسلمين والمسلمات الأحياء منهم والأموات تابع اللهم بيننا وبينهم بالخيرات إنك مجيب الدعوات إنك غافر الخطيئات